Good day, everyone, and we are now at our fourth module. So basically, for this week, we will be discussing, and for the succeeding weeks, we will be discussing the nursing process. Okay. So our objectives for the day. Our objectives for the day, you have apply critical thinking in the nursing process. Compare the goals and activities involved in each phases of the nursing process and be able to develop a nursing care plan based on the given case scenario. Okay, so first and foremost, before we deal with the different steps or phases of the nursing process, let us talk about critical thinking. Okay, so student nurses often encounter several challenges when they start their clinical duties or when they are faced with decision-making responsibilities. Oftentimes, there are a lot of the students, no, would ask how. No? How do we make decisions as nurses? How do nurses make decisions about patient care? Okay, what do we rely on to help us in decision-making? Okay, so these are the most common problems or concerns of student nurses, no, because they may lack experience in clinical setting, making it difficult for them to make quick and accurate decisions. Okay, the pressure of being responsible for patient care can be very overwhelming, most especially to new student nurses, which can lead to stress and anxiety. But fortunately, as nurses, we are guided, or we can make use of a certain tool that would help us in this crucial task of decision making. Okay, so critical thinking. So this is a mental process, actively and skillfully perceive, analyze, synthesize, and evaluate the collected information through observation, experience, and communication that leads to a decision for action. Okay, so it's a process. No, it's a process that we undergo, okay, or we deal with every time we are faced with any crossroad for deciding care for our patient. Or it may be defined as a tool, okay, utilized by nurses in the process of solving problems of the patient and decision-making process with creativity to enhance its effect. Okay, so basically, critical thinking, when we define in nursing practice, is discipline-specific, okay, of reflective reasoning process that may guide a nurse in generating, okay, implementing, and evaluating approaches for dealing with patient care and professional concerns, okay. And generally speaking, nurses are expected to use critical thinking to solve their clients' problems and make better decisions towards their care. Now, how am I ever going to learn how to make connections among all the data that I have about my patient? Okay, so these are the common response of a nursing student who is just learning some of the most basic skills in preparation for their nursing practice. Okay, and as I had mentioned, no, critical thinking helps in clinical judgment, okay, or nursing judgment. Okay, as a nurse, no, we should possess good problem-solving skills. Okay, it is not as always, no, that there is a clear textbook answer to any problem posed by your patient. Okay, so nurses must learn how to question, okay, ask questions, no, and look at different alternatives that may be applicable for one patient, but at certain times it may not be applicable to another patient. Okay, so basically, critical thinking can help you guide in this decision-making process. Okay, it is essential, highly essential, to safe, competent, and skillful nursing practice. Okay, so the amount of knowledge that nurses must utilize And the continuing rapid growth of this knowledge may prevent a nurse from being effective practitioners, no, if they attempt to solely base their practice or solely base their actions on informations that are acquired in their textbook or that was taught in the school. That's why we were saying, no, experience is very much essential. That's why if you would take a look at your course curriculum, no, or the curriculum of the nurse BSN program, okay, much of the time that you would be spending here learning is attributed to related learning experience, no, your exposure in the different clinical settings and community settings that would enrich your baseline knowledge in caring for your patients. Okay. Now, what are the different components of critical thinking? Okay, it has a scientific knowledge base. Okay, so nurses draw upon knowledge not just from the nursing profession but also from other subjects and fields, no? Because nurses deal holistically with human responses, they must derive meaningful information from other subject areas, okay? Making interdisciplinary connections, not to understand the significance of client data in order for you to plan effective interventions, okay? Knowledge regarding basic sciences, chemistry, okay, these are highly essential, okay? As I had mentioned, number two, you have experience, okay? So experience will be your best teacher, okay? Competencies. So nurses, though they navigate, no, although they are exposed to a highly stressful environment, okay, so nurses must operate, no, must function rapidly in evolving situations. This may include treatments, medication, the use of technology. These are constantly changing, okay, and your client's condition may fluctuate from time to time. So routine actions may therefore not be adequate to address a certain situation at hand. So careful assessment of the patient's signs and symptoms is highly essential. Okay? You must possess the proper attitude. Okay, so sabi nga natin, as we had mentioned, there is a complete or there is a specific set of attitude, no, that nurses must develop. Okay, to be able to create meaningful interpersonal nurse-patient relationships. Okay, and you have base your decisions on different standards that are set, okay, set to guide you in determining what is normal, okay, from what is abnormal, or based on your assessment to your patient. So this will help you make important decisions, no, throughout the workday. So nurses are tasked with making crucial decisions of various kinds, and this decision may often determine, no, the well-being and even the survival, okay, of your clients. So it is highly imperative that sound decisions are made by nurses. And employing critical thinking to gather, no, and interpret the information needed to make decisions is highly imperative, okay, in order for you to exercise good judgment or good clinical judgment. Okay, so nurses, no, may differ from making decisions, may differ from performance of different competencies based on their experiential level. Okay, so Patricia Benner may guide us in determining what are the common competencies that a novice nurse has compared to that of an expert nurse. Okay, so let us give a fine line of delineation between what or how does a novice nurse thinks compared to that of an expert nurse. Okay, so novice nurses and expert nurses demonstrate differences in thinking and decision-making process due to variations in experience, knowledge, and skill level. Okay? So commonly, let's start with they tend to organize knowledge as separate facts. Okay? As nurses, no? As novice nurses, they tend to rely on rules, guidelines, okay? So they rely heavily on protocols, no, provided in textbooks and training materials to guide them in their practice, okay? They focus so much on actions that they tend to forget to assess before acting, okay? So novice nurses' characteristic of thinking is mostly linear, okay? They may approach patient care in a linear and step-by-step manner, lacking the ability to anticipate maybe potential complications or variations in patients' responses. Okay? They may lack knowledge gained from actually doing a particular procedure, like say for example, listening to breath sounds. Okay? So since novice nurses, they are new to the clinical setting and have limited exposure to the real world patient care scenarios. Okay? They tend to focus more on procedures than on the patient's response to the procedure. So they are basically procedurally focused, no? They tend to focus on completing tasks and following procedures correctly without maybe fully understanding the rationale behind each actions. Okay. So these are the common characteristics of novice nurses as we compare them to experienced nurses and the way they think. Okay. So as expert, they tend to store knowledge in a highly organized and structured manner, making recall and information easier. Okay. So expertness nurses possesses advanced clinical judgment skills, allowing them to really anticipate, okay, potential complications, no, identify subtle changes in patient status and intervene proactively to prevent adverse outcomes. Okay. They assess and think things through before acting, okay, making them efficient decision makers, no? They make decisions efficiently and confidently, synthesizing all the information available, then prioritize interventions based on clinical judgment and critical thinking. Okay. They have a large storehouse of experiential knowledge, what abnormal breath sounds like, what subtle changes look like, okay? So expert nurses have years of experience in clinical practice, encountering a wide range of patient cases and situations. Okay, they become filled with a different background on what would a patient look like if they have this particular condition or disease. Okay, they know when it is safe to skip steps or do two steps together, because they are highly flexible and adaptive, okay? So they demonstrate flexibility and adaptability in their approach to patient care, making them being able to adjust their strategies based on changing patient conditions and contextual factors, okay? And they are able to focus on both the parts, okay, the procedures, and the whole, which is the patient response, because expert nurses tend to look at patients holistically, on a holistical perspective, okay? So they take patient care on a holistic approach, considering the patient's unique circumstances, preferences, and psychosocial factors in their decision-making process. Okay, so these are the benefits of using a critical thinking. Okay, and as nurses, as student nurses early on, we may benefit from cultivating this skill of developing critical thinking that would guide us in clinical judgment to make decisions towards patient care. Okay. So now let us proceed with the nursing process. Okay, so when we say nursing process, this is more of like a review, because maybe you have encountered this term. starting when you were discussing with your first year theoretical foundations in nursing. This was also discussed already under your health assessment, a preview on the different processes or phases of the nursing process. And maybe it would not hurt if we simply reintroduce, okay, the nursing process, since as a core subject for fundamentals of nursing, this is the main task of a nurse. Okay. So the nursing process is systematic and a dynamic framework that guides nurses in providing, take note, individualized and holistic care to your patient. Okay, so when we say individualized, okay, what may be applicable to one patient may not be applicable to every patient who has the same condition. Why? Because they have different physique, okay? They may have different gender, okay? They may have differences in history, okay, of the different diseases that their family has. That's why one may not be applicable to the other, even though they have the same condition. Okay. So it is organized. So when you say organized, there are different tasks for every phase that would require doing one first over that of the other. Okay. It is systematic, meaning it follows a step-by-step process. Okay. It is goal-oriented. Okay. Why? Because our plan of care would always be aimed at reaching a goal that we had set prior to the start of our interventions. Okay. And of course, humanistic care. Okay. Why? Because our client here is a person. Okay. So we need to provide efficient and effective care to our patient. Okay. Now, to review with, no, this is the framework for your or the phases of your nursing process. Okay. So you have their assessment, analyzing, reaching towards a nursing diagnosis. Then you have your planning. Okay, setting your goals, implementing. Okay, that's to carry out your plan. That's the doing part. And lastly, you have evaluating. Okay, so we look for changes with our assessment data. Okay, so the phases of the nursing process, if we may summarize, no, or if we may develop a mnemonics for you to be able to easily recall the different steps, you had ADPI, ADPIE. Okay. They have their nurse Marty memory tip number one. Okay. They have the nursing process has five essential steps. Okay. So you have assessment, diagnosis, planning, implementation, and evaluation. Okay. Now, under assessment, no, the first step involves gathering information. Okay. Then you have diagnosis, no? Here we make we cluster our collected data, okay, so that we can identify actual problems or potential problems of your patient. Okay. Then you have planning. We develop a plan of care in collaboration with the patient, their family as the significant others, and the different members of the healthcare team. You have your implementation, as I had mentioned a while ago, the doing part, okay? We carry out interventions to achieve our goal, okay? And then evaluation involves, again, reassessing, okay, the patient's response to the interventions that you have provided for them, okay? Response here may not be limited to verbal response, okay? So you would want to obtain information that would tell you that you were able to reach the that you were able to obtain your set goals, okay, in terms of the absence or the presence of the different signs and symptoms, comparing to your baseline data during assessment. Okay? So here, we tend to decide if we maybe modify the plan of care, maybe terminate the plan of care, or maybe so here, we decide whether we modify our plan of care, whether we continue our plan of care, or maybe we can terminate our plan of care. Okay, so these are the essential phases of the nursing process. Okay, now let us start with the first phase of the nursing process. Okay, so the first phase of the nursing process is assessment. Okay, so for today, we will be dwelling with the first phase, which is assessment. So what is assessment? Assessment is the deliberate and systematic collection of data to determine a client's current and past health status, functional status, and coping pattern. Okay, so the primary goal, take note of this, of assessment phase is to establish a database about the client's response to illness. Again, as we had mentioned a while ago, response here may not be limited to verbal response. Okay, so let's say, for example, a client has diabetes mellitus. The client's response to this particular illness are the different signs and symptoms that a client experiences together with this particular condition. Okay, so the activities involved in assessment phase is number one, collecting data. Okay, so nurses collect subjective and objective data through various methods for which we would discuss later. Okay, what are these different methods? But to give an overview, basically this involves interviewing your patient. Okay, obtaining the health history, performing physical examinations, you observe, okay, for your client's response to any condition. Okay, you review medical records and you look for results of diagnostic tests. So basically, these are all included in your data collection. Okay. Then after collecting this particular data, no, this information, you would tend to organize them. Okay, what do we mean when we say we organize this particular data? Okay, so we group this collected data according to how you were able to obtain them. Like say, through interview, what are the information that you were able to obtain through interview? Okay, through physical assessment, through health history, through observation. So we organize them, okay? And then after collecting this data, of course, we should validate if this data are existing, okay? We should validate if these are consistent with the client's actions, okay? Based on your observation, okay? And of course, definitely, you need to document all your assessment findings. Okay, this may include, again, as we have mentioned or we summarize, subjective or objective data, your observations. This has to be documented accurately and concisely on your client's medical record. Okay, we need to use standardized terminologies, no? Okay, and of course, we need to follow the hospital policies and guidelines in terms of documentation. Okay, so take into consideration what are the guidelines of your hospital for which you are having your clinical exposure in terms of the acceptable abbreviations, terminologies to describe a particular condition maybe or particular assessment data. Okay, now, there are different types of assessment, okay? They may be clustered or grouped according to when they were obtained, okay? So you have there initial assessment. Okay, so when we say initial assessment, these are performed within a specified time period and is used to establish a complete database. Okay, so when do we do initial assessment? So basically, the first time we have an interaction with our patient, maybe during the time that they are at the outpatient department or your first contact with your patient. Okay, so basically, you need to obtain all your baseline data because this would give you a parameter to evaluate, you know, the effectiveness of your plan of care. Next, you have a problem-focused assessment. Okay, so it's an ongoing process integrated with care and basically to determine the status of a specific problem. Okay, so usually we use this as nurses when our patients are hospitalized. Okay, so when they are confined, no, we tend to look for changes or the progression of a particular sign and symptom, like say for pain, example. Your initial assessment data upon the first day of the confinement, maybe the client had a pain scale of 9 over 10, okay? And maybe around 2 days after, you may ask for the pain scale at present, okay? So maybe your client can say, I still have around 7 over 10. So if you've compared 7 over 10 versus that of your initial assessment of 9 over 10, then definitely you can see that the pain scale is declining. Okay. But then again, in as much as possible, we would want at least to very minimize the pain experience. So maybe the second day of admission, okay, the third day that the client is confined, no, you tend to reevaluate. Okay, so that is problem focused. Okay, time lapse occurs several months after the initial. Okay, compares current status to baseline. Okay, so this can be done when the client maybe had been discharged from the hospital, and around the time that the client was able to come back for a follow-up checkup, usually around a week after the hospital discharge. Okay, so that's time lapse. Okay, then you have emergency. These are performed during physiologic or psychologic crisis, okay, and basically identifies life-threatening problems or identify new or overlooked problems. Okay, so basically, like say, under critical conditions, no, we pay particular attention to the most presenting problem at that moment. Maybe like the patient had a cardiac arrest. Okay, so a rapid assessment on the ABCs, airway, breathing, and the circulation, would help us provide rapid interventions, no, in order to prevent cardiopulmonary arrest. Okay, so we need to immediately provide CPR for that case. So that's under emergency type of assessment. Okay, next, let us proceed with the types of assessment data. So basically, they are just clustered into two. You have subjective data, and then you have objective data. Okay, subjective data, these are symptoms or covert data. Okay, so these are only apparent to the person affected. Okay, so take note, no, for you to easily remember subjective data, they start with letter S. Okay, so these are symptoms. Okay, symptoms. Okay, in Tagalog, para mas madaling maintindihan, subjective data, sabi ng pasyente. Okay, sabi ng relative ng pasyente. Okay, so these are verbalizations of the patient or the relatives. Okay, why we consider relatives? So maybe the patient could be like infant, no, they cannot verbalize, so the source of information are the significant others. Okay, so again, subjective data are symptoms only apparent to the person affected. Okay, they can only be described, of course, by the person affected. Okay? This may include sensations, feelings, values, beliefs, attitudes, and perception of personal health status and life situation. Okay, so again, subjective, symptoms, verbalizations, or sabi ng pasyente. Okay, next you have objective data. So when we say objective data, these are signs or overt data. Okay, so you can, for you to be able to easily recall, objective data are those we can observe. Okay? Observe. Okay? So they are defined, or objective data are defined as those signs which are detectable by an observer. Okay? They can be measured. Okay? So maybe you had used a tool, okay, to measure a particular data or test against an accepted standard. Say for example, laboratory tests, okay? They can be seen by the observer, they can be heard, they can be felt, or they can be smelled, okay? So these are obtained through observation or by physical examination. Okay, so you have observe, objective data. Okay. So again, we have here another memory tip. So you have there another memory tip for you to be able to recall easily your subjective and your objective data. These are your types of assessment data. Subjective data starts with letter S. These are sabi ni pasyente, okay, or your symptoms, okay, things that can be only described by the person who feels it, okay. Objective data starts with letter O, objective, obtained by observation. So, obtained by observation. Okay. Now, to facilitate recall, okay, so let's have a very short activity. Okay, maybe you can take down, or maybe you can get your notes, okay, and identify the following data, assessment data, if there are subjective or objective. Okay, so we'll be checking this during our discussion. Okay, number one, Aling Maria says giniginaw ako. Okay, is that subjective or objective? Number two, you have James is limping. Number three, Raha's respiratory rate is 16. Number four, Jay says he cannot urinate. Number five, you have crackles are auscultated. Number six, you have surgical incision is dry. Okay, so take note. No? We'll be checking that during our face-to-face discussion. Next, you have, okay, sources of data. So where do we get this data or information that we are gathering? Number one, of course, we call them primary source of data if they came directly from your client. So these are primary source of data, and the only primary source of data is your client. Other than that, they are considered secondary sources of data. They can either be your family members, your significant others, okay, your patient's record, your members of the health team, okay, maybe from the doctor, maybe from the medical technologist, the respiratory therapist, okay? And you have your related literatures. Okay, so these are secondary sources. And take note, no? Whether they came from the primary or the secondary source, validation is still essential. Validating if these are existing is highly imperative among nurses. Next, methods of data collection. As I had mentioned, now we'll be discussing them one by one. How do we gather data? Okay, number one, you have observation. So under observation, we gather data using our senses. Okay, so you use your five senses. Nurses, observe the client's behavior, appearance, mobility, how well they move, okay, their speech, their cognitive function, the way they think, their affect, okay, the way they react, and interactions with other people, okay? They may take into consideration, note any signs of distress, okay? Maybe frowning, maybe gazing, okay? Discomfort, signs of discomfort, maybe, like say, holding a particular body part, okay? Or abnormalities, and assess for non-verbal cues that may indicate anxiety or pain, okay? So, observation, no, using your five senses are used to obtain the following types of data. Maybe you have your skin color, okay? So you can use your eyes, your vision for that, no? Body or breath odors with the use of your sense of smell, okay? Lung or heart sounds, okay, facilitated by the use of your stethoscope. Okay, so you can hear from them. Then you have the skin temperature by touching. Okay, so these are the different types of data you can obtain through observation. Okay, next you have interview. Okay, so under interview, we define that as a planned communication. Okay, planned communication or conversation with a specific purpose, maybe. Definitely, no? So you do not communicate without the goal in mind, no? And your goal in mind is, of course, number one, to identify problems of your mutual concern, okay? You as a nurse, and of course, the patient. To evaluate changes, okay? To teach your client, no? To provide support, provide counseling or therapy. So basically, these are the purposes of interview, okay? So nurses need to construct or conduct structured interviews with clients primarily to gather information about their current health conditions, okay? We call that under your nursing health history, the chief complaint, okay? What's the reason why the patient is at present in the hospital consulting a physician, okay? Next, you have the medical history, okay? You have the present medical history, past history, okay? You have a familial history, okay? So these are obtained through your interview with your client. Different lifestyle factors, psychosocial factors, okay? And of course, definitely, we do interview in order to establish, or we communicate with our client in order to establish rapport. So applying the principles that we had learned from the previous modules on communication, okay? So basically, no, to establish rapport, we ask open-ended questions and specific questions, no, to develop, no, a database of your client's present condition. And definitely, no, to actively listen to your client's responses to each of the questions that you have. Okay. This may also include past medical conditions, no, any kind of diseases that patient had previously, any surgeries that the patient had undergone, okay, in the previous years, allergies to any food, medication history, what are the different medications that at present the client is taking, okay? Or any allergies in relation to medication, okay? And then you have this, no? We use as nurses standardized forms, okay? Or electronic health records to document this particular information that we are obtaining from our client through interview, okay? So different institution, of course, has different forms or maybe manner of documenting the obtained information through assessment. Okay. Some hospitals may be highly technical and highly technologically advanced that they use electronic health records or EHRs to document data or initial database and of course the progress of the client's condition. So you no longer need to write your nurse's notes. You just tick the different boxes on that particular system, no? Guided by an interface with a computer, okay, to guide you in documenting your patient's progress. Okay? And of course, as we had discussed previously during communication, we need to consider a lot of things when we are interviewing our client or when we are communicating with our patient. No, this may include consideration of the time, the place where or the environment where the communication or the interview is being held, the seating arrangement, no? Are you facing your client? Okay? The distance between the nurse and the patient, and the type of language that you would be using. Okay, so these are considered when we are doing our interview. Okay. And next, of course, you have physical examination. So, okay, nurses perform a systematic physical assessment to assess the client's vital signs, okay, general appearance, skin, neurovascular, cardiovascular, respiratory, gastrointestinal, musculoskeletal, and other relevant body systems. Okay? And of course, we do have different techniques that we use, okay, to perform physical examination. Okay? So basically, these are the methods of data collection. Okay? Now, okay, so let's have a nurse multi memory trip number 3. Okay, they have IPPA. So these are the different techniques used in physical assessment. You have inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. Okay, so nurses, no, uses observation, okay, their senses in order to perform these 4 techniques. You have, again, IPPA, to be able to obtain information or data like your blood pressure, okay, your pulses, heart and lung sounds, skin temperature and moisture, or maybe muscle strength. Okay, so make use of different techniques like this in order to obtain data, as we had mentioned. Okay, now let us have the different frameworks, no, for assessing or nursing assessment. So in the nursing process, we can use various frameworks to guide us, okay, in the assessment phase. Each, let us discuss them or emphasize the different aspects of holistic patient care in the use of these different frameworks. Okay, so we may group them according to nursing models framework, non-nursing models, and you have your wellness models. Okay, so let us start with your nursing models. Number 1, you have your Gordon's functional health pattern. I believe you are already done with the discussion on this functional health pattern. But basically, this framework organizes assessment data into 11 categories or patterns. Okay, which includes starting from health perception, health management, up until value belief pattern. So each pattern provides a structured approach to assess various aspects of a person's health and lifestyle, facilitating a holistic understanding of their health needs and guiding nursing care interventions. So let us consider a patient admitted to the hospital for heart failure. Okay, so using Gordon's functional health pattern, the nurse can conduct a thorough assessment to gather data pertaining to the present or the current condition of your patient in each of these patterns. Alright, so I think I had given a concrete example on how this functional health pattern can help you obtain a comprehensive assessment. So by systematically assessing each functional health pattern, the nurse can gain a comprehensive understanding of the patient's current health status. The nurse can also be able to identify areas of strength and concern and can collaborate with the healthcare team to develop a holistic plan of care, promoting optimal health and well-being of our patient. Okay. Next, you have OREM's self-care deficit theory. Okay, so according to OREM, the assessment is focused on the ability of the patient to perform self-care activities. Okay, so self-care capabilities may be measured in terms of their deficits or their dependencies, the patient's dependencies to the nurse is determined to be able to provide the necessary interventions required to be able to reach your common goal that you had set. Next, you have Roy's adaptation model. So according to Roy, it emphasizes the assessment of the patient's adaptation responses to the different stressors that they encounter, whether they be physiological, psychological, or maybe social responses to the different stressors, And the goal is to identify areas where there is ineffective adaptation that may require nursing interventions, in order to promote a positive adaptation to any stressor. Okay, then you have your non-nursing models. Okay, since we had mentioned before, that critical thinking involves the use of a wide range of scientific knowledge base. Number one would be the body system model. Okay, so the different systems of our body may be used as a framework for performing assessment data or assessment data gathering. Like say, the assessment may like be focused on the respiratory system, okay, the cardiovascular system. Okay, so this can serve as a framework for assessment to your patient, most especially, of course, after determining which particular body system is involved on the presenting condition of your patient. Okay, then you have a Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So if we could remember, the Maslow's model prioritizes the assessment of the patient's need based on hierarchy, okay? Starting with the most physiologic as the most basic need, like you have air, water, food, shelter, and progressing through safety, love and belongingness, esteem, and of course, your self-actualization. So nurses assess the patient's level of need, that may require immediate attention. Of course, paying particular attention to the most basic need first before any problems which are of higher hierarchy. Okay, then you have developmental theories. Okay, so if you could remember on your psychology subjects before, we were able to establish or determine and discuss the theory of psychosexual development theory. So we can see here that there are five stages of Sigmund Freud's theory, starting with oral, anal, phallic, latency, and genital stage. Next, we proceed with Erik Erikson's psychosocial development. Here, he describes the different stages of development that a person or a human being undergoes as to trust versus mistrust, autonomy versus shame, initiative versus guilt, industry versus inferiority, identity versus role confusion, intimacy versus isolation,
generativity versus stagnation, and integrity versus despair. Erickson believed that a strong sense of a personal identity was important for developing intimate relationships. His studies have demonstrated that those persons with poor sense of self tend to have less committed relationships and are more likely to struggle with emotional isolation, loneliness, and depression. So by utilizing these frameworks and models during the assessment phase, nurses can conduct thorough and systematic assessment so as to identify patient need and develop nursing care plan.
Okay. Next. Branching questions. Okay. In nursing assessment can serve the purpose of delving deeper into scientific areas of concern. Okay, identifying patterns of client problems and gathering more detailed information together or to guide your nursing care. Okay, so as nurses, no, when we say branching questions, these are continuous questioning based on the responses of your client to help you gain or obtain details of the complaint of your patient or the presenting problem of your patient. So by using branching questions, nurses can uncover relevant information that may not have been maybe initially volunteered by your client as a complaint. Okay? So leading to a more comprehensive understanding of the client need and facilitating the development of appropriate care plans. Okay, so given this scenario, so you have here your client data, then you have the branching questions, no? From a particular question, you would have follow-up questions, no? And the purpose or which particular client pattern you are referring to when you were asking this particular question. Okay. Given an example maybe of a patient presenting facial grimace, okay? So your first question would be is to ask, are you having pain? Okay? Since this is a close-ended question, so this is only answerable by yes or no. Okay? This way you can verify the initial obtained data of facial grimace. So maybe you're entertaining the idea in your mind that your patient is having pain, okay, because he's grimacing. Okay? So you can verify that by asking, are you having pain? So if the client says yes, okay, so this particular pattern is obtained towards determining if there is presence of pain. Okay, but your next question would be, what kind of pain is this? Is it acute or chronic? Okay, so we can review, no, the difference between acute and chronic illness, as we had discussed, no, is based on maybe the time frame, okay, the extensiveness of the pain, okay, was it abrupt or was it gradually experienced by your patient, okay? So your next question would be, tell me how long has it been bothering you, okay? So it would lead you to obtaining an answer to your next question of client pattern, which is to determine whether the pain is acute or chronic. So your client may respond, no? The client reports 8 months duration. So if we consider by definition, no, this can be classified as chronic pain. Okay, so it extends for more than 6 months. Okay? And of course, by definition, you understand that chronic pain may cause lifestyle changes, no? So you need to adjust everything that you are doing because of a pain that you are experiencing. Okay? So you may need to ask, no, what are the different lifestyle changes that the person or the patient is experiencing? Okay? So to guide you on obtaining this, no, you may ask where the patient's pain is located. Okay? So show me, or can you show me where the pain is located? Okay, so the client moves the hand and arm slowly. Okay. So if the client moves the arm and the hand slowly, still, no, you're still not sure Where is it located? So you can ask, is it in your hand, okay, your wrist, or your lower arm? Okay, why am I asking this? Because this may lead to a problem in terms of mobility. So there would be instances where there are certain activities that the client has limitations in performing or in doing, maybe in mobility, because he has been experiencing pain. Okay, next. So it tells you, no? Is it in your hand, wrist, or lower arm? So the client described, no? Okay, maybe it's on my lower arm. Okay, so the next question can be, can you describe the pain for me? Okay, so the client describes is as constant burning. Okay, so there are different kinds of pain. Maybe stabbing, okay? Maybe pinpoint, okay? Pain, dull pain, okay? Crushing, okay? So here it was described as constant burning. In what way does it affect what you normally do? Okay, so are there any limitation in the lifestyle of the patient? Okay, kasi this would help you identify if there are self-care deficits already, no? Are there things that the client usually do, no, when the client doesn't have pain that he can no longer do because of the pain that he is experiencing at present? So the client says, no, he has trouble lifting arm above the shoulder, okay, level. Okay, so if the client says, I am having trouble lifting my arm at shoulder level, so habi niya hanggang dito lang. Okay, so if you are given this particular scenario, so you are thinking maybe there are things that he can no longer do or has trouble doing, like maybe dressing himself, okay, removing his clothes because he can no longer lift his hands, no? Okay. Or maybe feeding. Okay. So does the client have difficulty in feeding? Okay. So these are all, sorry, self-care related difficulties. Okay. And then next question would be, syempre, of course, if there is pain, no? You ask the client, what does he usually do to relieve the pain that he is experiencing? So, what do you do to relieve the pain? So, the client may say, the client, I'm using warm shower and I take acetaminophen, okay, or Tylenol as my pain reliever. And of course, your next question would be, do this, no, methods provide relief from pain? Okay, so is it effective? When, of course, if the patient goes to the hospital and saying this is still painful, no, of course, they are no longer effective at the moment. That's why that prompted your client to go to the hospital. Okay, so the client may say, no, it no longer eliminates the pain. Okay, so there is the pattern on health care management. So how does the client, no, provide relief from any complaint that he or she is experiencing? So these are your branching question. Okay, so if you deal with your patient, no, you provide questions, no, that can lead you in order for you to identify a particular deviation from a normal pattern of an activity of daily living. Okay, so this can help you provide details, no, important details on the complaints of your patient, the current health status of your patient at present. Okay, so to cite another example, no, let us have here an animation, no, of a nurse and a patient, no, interviewing regarding the case of a diabetic patient and the use of branching questions to provide details on the complaints of our patient. Okay, so as you had seen, no, by asking this branching question, the nurse gains insight into various aspects of the patient's diabetes management to include your diet, medication adherence, symptoms, and lifestyle factors. No, this allows the nurse, no, to identify patterns of client problems such as dietary choices, no, medication non-adherence, no, stress, which may contribute to the rising difficulty of the patient in terms of controlling her blood sugar levels. So with this information, the nurse can collaborate with the different members of the healthcare team to develop a tailored plan of care to address the challenges and needs of the patient in terms of managing his or her diabetes complaints. Okay, so another example, you have there, no? A patient is lying in bed holding his stomach while squeezing his eyes shut. Okay, so when we use branching question in relation to your Gordon's functional health pattern, no? Your questions can be this. Okay, so in terms of pain, no? You can ask, are you having pain to verify? How long has it been? Okay, to determine the duration. Okay. Is it in your stomach to determine the location? Okay. So can you rate your pain on a scale of 0 to 10? So it determines the intensity of the pain. Okay. And then how does it feel? This would help you obtain responses regarding the characteristic of the pain that the client is experiencing. Okay. In terms of mobility, no? When was the last time you turned in your bed? Okay. Moving sa bed. And then can you stand up? Okay, so this may be altered if the patient is experiencing pain. Okay, in terms of sleep, no, how was your sleep in relation to the pain? So maybe you're entertaining the idea in your mind that maybe sleep of the client is also another area of concern because of pain. Then you have nutrition, no, when did you last eat? Okay, what did you eat before you felt the discomfort? Okay. So, this may guide you in obtaining the source or the cause of the stomach ache of your patient. Okay? And then you have your healthcare management, of course, no? What did you do to relieve pain? Okay? So, these branching questions can be helpful for you as nurses when you are developing your interview. You structure your interview based on the complaints of your patient or the presenting problem. Okay. So with this, no, I hope these are sufficient enough, no, to help you in the first phase of the nursing process, which is assessment. Okay. So we'll be having a series of lectures, no, in relation to Module 4, which is the nursing process. So, succeedingly, we'll have nursing diagnosis, okay, then followed by planning, then you have implementation, and you have evaluation, okay, as the different segments of module number 4, which is the nursing process, okay. And at the end of the discussion, we will be able to develop a comprehensive a nursing care plan towards a particular patient. Okay, so when we meet face to face, we'll be having a discussion of a case scenario specific to your section so that we'll be guided accordingly on how to develop a nursing care plan pertaining to one case of a patient. Okay, so stay tuned for the next installment of this discussion on the nursing process.